Hello everyone, today I'm going to share with you about a project I've been working on. The idea is to make a portable set for my son of a few steam engines, a few N-scale steam engines. N-scale because originally I thought it was the smallest engine you could buy in the market, which I would seem to have been mistaken. I guess I'm not very knowledgeable when it comes to the trains hobby, and I later found out that no, that there's a T and Z, which are even smaller than the N-scale. Anyway, these three N-scale engines that I'm using, N-scale are pretty good size, and I guess I got excited. My son is just a year old at the moment, but eventually I'll continue to make a portable portfolio or something, and the idea is to run this from either a 12 volt lithium battery or lithium ion battery or a lead acid battery, which I'm using at the moment because they're cheaper, and just to make a portable playset and take it, you know, when traveling or going to restaurants and stuff. And I want to make a control module with Bluetooth or either Bluetooth or wireless, and then he can just use the phone to control the speed and the direction of the trains. At the moment, I just made a very simple Arduino code that just has a motion sensor, and then as you walk by, it runs a program that lasts for a couple of several minutes. So, I'm gonna share with you all the hardware and software and how you can make this work. This project is actually would actually be pretty handy for those of you who want to make an exhibit at your house or that have a train store and just want to have a setup that turns on as customers walk in. Then they can have a pretty general idea of your trains and what you could build with them. Also, it would save you the money of buying the retail power supplies, and well, you could create your own power supply for this project and customize, you know, speeds and different functions that you could do with your locomotives at your house or your store. Let's focus on the hardware aspect of our project. So what are we going to need? We're going to need an Arduino Uno. We're also going to need a full bridge motor driver, an L298N. We're going to need jumper wires, female to male jumper wires, and our power supply, which can either be a lead acid battery. I meant to buy a lithium ion one, but lead acid are cheaper. Or you could use a 12 volt power supply. In this case, I am using a 6 amp power supply because of some LED lights that I installed, but 4 amp 12 volt power supply, 40 watts should be good enough for this project. All right, what else do we need? Well, we obviously need the trains. So here's Thomas and here's James. We're gonna need a N-scale track. I bought what is called code 80. And we're gonna need the track joiners as well. And we're gonna need the terminals that are gonna be connected to our full bridge motor driver, the L298N. And we're gonna need wire. So if you have an Arduino Uno, you could use jumper wires and that'll be good enough. If you make your own Arduinos like I do, I like to use 22 gauge wire, and for the 12 volt application, in this case controlling the both of our trains, I like to use 18 gauge wire for that. They don't withdraw a lot of current, maybe 800 milliamps max when going at full throttle or full speed, but I still like to use 18 gauge for the 12 volt applications, just in case. Now, as I mentioned before, I do make my own Arduinos because I started doing this a few years ago, and back in the day it was cheaper to make your own than actually buy an Arduino, but nowadays it might just be easier for you guys to buy your own Arduino than make your own. I have a bunch of different projects at home, so I just got a lot of supplies to make my own Arduinos for different projects. So that being said, here's the Arduino that controls our trains project. So we start with the power supply. which is provided by the full bridge motor driver. Actually, as we'll go in detail, it has a port that supplies 5 volt CC, which is perfect for the for a circuit over here for Arduino. So we get the power supply from there. And as you can see, here is our USB mail port to communicate with the Arduino IDE software. It's an I2C serial communications. This is the ground, the 5 volt CC that are being provided over here. You can find this guy as a 6-pin CH340G USB 2. Let's see how this communicates. Actually, I'm gonna open the pin out real quick for the Arduino to see what we're talking about. So the actual physical port for the Arduino, which is the physical port number 2, which would be the Arduino port 0, is the receiver. So it will be this guy. Pin 0 is the receiver, and then pin number 1 is our transmitter. So this transfers the information from the Arduino to the computer, you know, like whenever you're uploading the software or you have the serial monitor open, and this one is the one receiving the bits from the computer into the Arduino. So that will be physically pin 2 and 3. Now let's see our code. In our code, we have pin number 5 as the green LED output for our RGB LED that we have over here, and pin number 6 as our red LED. So let's see how this goes. Here's pin number 5, which is the green LED, is this node over here. Pardon the confusion, I made a mistake with the color labeling of the wires here. So basically, this blue wire that you see over here is gonna be
the green LED
output, or the supply for the RGB LED, and is this node right here. Now number 6, which is a red LED, will be this node right here. Pin number 6 in the Arduino pinout is gonna be our red LED. Now, as you can see, it doesn't go directly into the LED. It goes to this node right here, which is 15. You can't really see it, but there's a 110 ohm resistor underneath the RGB LED. You're supposed to use 220 ohm resistors when using the LEDs in the 5 volt environment like this to prevent from burning them. To be quite honest with you, I like the LEDs to be bright, so I somewhat skip the resistors. Now, the red color, you will burn the red LED, so I actually do use a resistor for that, but I have been using on 110 ohm resistor, and that seems to work just fine. So that being said, here's your green, pin number 5, which is this node. Here's your red, pin number 6, which is this node, and our ground. All right, so now let's go to pin number 4. Pin number 4 is actually the only input that we're going to be using in this project for the Arduino. That's going to be the motion sensor status. So whenever the infrared light from the motion sensor gets interrupted, that's going to activate our software. So here we go. This is pin number 4. This node over here is a little confusing. Sorry about that. The picture has a bit of an angle. So is this blue wire on node number 9? So is this pin right here. Now let's see the rest of our pins. So let's start with pin number 7. Pin number 7 is James Forward, which is gonna be this node right here, node number 2. Pin number 8 is gonna be James Reverse. This node right here is the first node, actually, node number 1. Then pin 9 is going to be a MOSFET for the LEDs that I installed later on into the project. It's not in the code I'm going to show you guys. I'm sorry about that. I added that later on. Pin number 10 is this node right here, node number 2, which is the PWM signal that drives Thomas's speed. Now, pin number 11 is this node right here, node number 3, which is gonna drive James' pulse modulated signal, which is gonna drive James' speeds as well. And pin number 12. Okay, pin number 12 is going to be the output for Thomas reverse. Pin number 13 is going to be the output for Thomas forward. So how does this work? We'll see in the code later on, but whenever we send to the full bridge motor signal high, say in pin number 12, and low in pin number 13, that's going to mean that this is going to be negative, so this is going to be positive, and so the direction that Thomas is going to go in that particular moment is going to be reverse. Now, if we do the opposite, if we send the high output on signal number 13 or 5 volts in number 13, and then ground or low output on pin number 12, that's going to make then this one negative, this one positive, so Thomas is going to go forward. All right, so I beg your pardon and the confusion that this may cause, but this is the finished circuit. So as you can see, there are some additional wires. I ended adding up another steam engine. So I modified this, and this wire right here that was supposed to be the motion sensor input, I actually ended up adding the other steam engine over here with an additional full bridge motor driver, and another L298N. And I moved the motion sensor input over here to node number 9, which, if we see right here, is our analog input 0 that you can configure in the Arduino to be a digital input or output as well. So I configured as a digital input. And over here, again, as you can see, this is a PWM. So basically, I use this tree for the third train, and I moved the motion sensor from this pin over here, which if you see, this is the original picture of the circuit. There's only one wire here, which is the motion sensor output, in this case, inputting a signal in the Arduino. There's nothing here, and there's only one wire here. So again, I added another steam engine over here, and I just moved this over here. But for the purpose of this video, we're gonna leave it like this. And I'm sorry about the confusion this may cause. Just ignore these two wires over here, and pretend this wire is right here, and there's nothing here. Just like this. So, all right, let's move forward. How is our motor driver configured? Here it is. This is our L298N, and we have on this side Thomas's track, which again, as I was explaining before, we can change the direction, so we can make this one be positive and this one be negative, or vice versa, this one be negative and this one be positive, depending whether we want him to go forward or reverse. And it is a 12 volts DC output signal. Now, this port right here is, you're gonna remove this jumper, and we're gonna connect pin 10, which is the pulse modulated signal, into this pin right here. Now, this is gonna be the Thomas forward signal, and this N3 is gonna be the Thomas reverse signal. So basically, this is motor B and this is motor A. We are, remember, we're treating our engines as if they were a simple motor, a DC motor. Thomas is DC motor B, and the wire that goes into the motor is basically, or are basically going to be the tracks. And same here, the wire that goes into James are actually going to be the tracks. So when this is a simple digital signal, so whenever we send this one high and this one low, that means positive negative, so Thomas is going to go forward. And if we send the high here and a low here, that means positive negative, so Thomas is going to go reverse. So again, this is James's track, same concept, 12 volt DC PWM, I'm sorry, 12 volt DC output signal. And these three pins right here are going to control James. This is our digital output 7, which is going to be James forward. This comes from the Arduino as well, is digital output 8, which is James Reverse. And this one is going to be our PWM signal that is going to drive James's speed. So again, we're going to remove this jumper. Now, we've got, these are the inputs where we're going to supply power into our bridge motor driver. So we're going to supply 12 volts DC, positive into this pin, ground, and then this 5 volts DC, this is actually an output. This is where we are supplying the 5 volts into our Arduino, as we saw in the previous picture. So we share the same ground. We're going to supply 5 volts into the Arduino from these two pins right here. And this one is our power supply, whether you bought the lead acid battery or the actual 4 amp power supply. Now, this short video that I'm showing right here is not actually mine. I'm quoting Team PSI, which is a great YouTube channel if you guys want to check it out. It's just to give you a visual of how we're using the trains here, or the steam engines. Basically, he's showing how you can change the positive and negative, as I was explaining earlier in the configuration, and how we can make the motor rotate, like in the first example, clockwise and then counterclockwise, just by reverting the high and low outputs in the code, which I'm not showing his code right here, but it's a very, very simple code where he just configured one output to be high and the other one to be low, and then just vice versa. Alright, so we're going to focus on the software part of the project at the moment. I'm going to open the code file, which I named it Train Speed, here in the Arduino IDE software. So I'm going to put images of the pinout just as a mere reference, but again, we are going to look at the code at the moment. So as you can see at the beginning, I declared our variables are integers. And, you know, you have Thomas forward, reverse, James forward, reverse, which pin 8, and then pin 9 is an LED light that I have not installed yet. Thomas and James, the pulse modulated signal, PWM signal, are going to be pins 10 and 11. So going to the setup of the code, you can see here we have again Thomas as an output signal, pin 10, and James as an output signal as well, pin 11. Again, all pulse modulated signal. And okay, so pins 5, 6, and 4. 5 and 6 are green and red for an LED, an RGB LED that I installed, just to display the status of the code. And pin 4 was the input from the motion sensor. Okay, so motion sensor, we're going to digital read the pin 4, right, and 6 high, 5 low
are going to be your indicator of whether the software is running, trains are running or no. So when your 5 is low and your 6 is high, that means the RGB LED is going to display a red status, which means the program is not running. So there is the Arduino is at that moment reading a digital signal from the motion sensor, and which is 0, is null. So it's just continually reading until, you know, the IR light from the motion sensor is interrupted. Then you'll have a high digital signal from your motion sensor, which is going to do a digital read 4 from it. And when that happens, the program is going to start running. So first thing that happens is we set Thomas at a PWM raw value of 30, or speed of 13%, and then James at 50, going a little bit faster. Then we just accelerate that to 50 and 100, and then we go a little bit faster at 100, 150, 150, 200, 200, 255. It's just a gradual increase to show that the trains can be running at different speeds, and you'll see for some of them I do a delay of 5 seconds, for some of them I do a slightly longer delay, but anyway, an average of 5 seconds. Then we go all the way up to 255, which is the max speed, and then we gradually decrease the speeds again until the trains come to a complete halt. So you can see still a delay of 5 seconds at 150 for Thomas and James. I actually make them go to same speed. Whenever we're decreasing the speeds, they go to same speed. And then the minimum value I could find the trains to run was a 30. Again, delay of 5 seconds, and then 5 seconds for 50. But then Thomas goes at 30, and James comes to a complete halt, a 15-second stop. So as you can see, for James, the speed is zero. Forward and reverse are low, both of them, and then the delay is 15,000 milliseconds. And then we do the opposite. So then Thomas comes to a complete stop, and we have James going backwards at 47% speed, and again we do a delay of 15,000 milliseconds. Then as you can see, for the end of our code, Thomas goes in reverse, so we set up the reverse signal as high and forward low, and then Thomas is gonna be going in reverse very slow at a speed of 16% with a raw value of 40 in the PWM signal, and this is going to last for 25,000 milliseconds. And then, at the end of our code, both of them come into a 3-second stop. And then the code restarts, and your LED goes back into red, and the Arduino is going to continue to look for motion, and then restart the program again. And that's basically it. So as you can see, I put an image on the right side where you can see each wire coming from the Arduino into the control board, and you have the different colors and pin outputs of each and every single wire pin that goes into the H-bridge. So this is how the code actually looks like. Or the live code per se, as the trains are running right after the motion sensor activates the program. I'm gonna put here in the upper left corner the serial monitor, so you can see what is going on as the trains are running and the speeds are increasing, beg your pardon, and the trains go forward, backwards, etc. It's faded in a little, so you can sort of read the feedback from the serial that I added into the code. Hope you enjoy.
Step aside, partner, it's my day. Bend an ear and listen to my version.
A really solid Tennessee excursion.
Pardon me, boy, is that the Chattanooga juju?
Yes, yes, track 29.
Boy, you can give me a shine.
Can you afford to board Chattanooga choo-choo?
I got my fare
and just a trifle to spare.
You leave the Pennsylvania station about a quarter to four. Read a magazine and then you're in Baltimore.
Dinner in the diner, nothing could be finer
than to have your ham and eggs in Carolina.
When when you hear the whistle blowing 8 to the bar, then you know that Tennessee is not very far.
Jam all over calling, gotta keep it rolling.
Ooh, ooh, Chattanooga, there you are.
There's gonna be a certain party at the station.
This is how the final setup looked like after adding the lights. It looked pretty nice. They would fade in right when the program started before the trains would start going, and then as the trains turned off, the lights would remain on for a minute or so, and then they would fade off again, and so on. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. Please subscribe to the channel, like the video if you liked it, and I'll eventually add more videos on how to do random projects at home, installing lights and stuff. Thanks for watching again.